Good evening. I'm Stesha Brandon, the Literature and Humanities Program Manager at the Seattle Public Library. As we begin tonight, I would like to acknowledge that we are on Indigenous land. Here in Seattle, we are on the traditional unceded territories of the Coast Salish people, specifically the Duwamish people. We honor their elders past and present and thank them for their stewardship of this land. Welcome to the first in our five-part series, Radical Self-Acceptance as Activism, curated by Olaiya Land and presented in partnership with Third Place Books. We're grateful to our author series sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, and the Seattle Times for generous support of library programs. Thank you as well to the Seattle Public Library Foundation. Private gifts to the foundation from thousands of donors help the library provide free programs and services that touch the lives of everyone in our community. I have a couple quick announcements before we get started. You can find books by Dr. Devon Price at our partner bookseller, Third Place Books. They're open for browsing and delivery, and their website is thirdplacebooks.com, and we'll also pop the link to their website in the chat below. And I wanted to let you know we have closed captioning for this event. You can access the closed captioning by clicking on the icon at the bottom of your screen. And tonight, after Olaiya and Dr. Price are done chatting, we'll have time for questions from you. You can ask your questions at any time during the program by writing them in the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen. And after the program, we're interested in hearing from you. We'll post a link to a program survey in the chat. We'd appreciate it if you took a minute after the event to fill that out. We'd love to hear what you think. Now, I'm delighted to introduce tonight's speakers. Olaiya Land is the founder and editor of Lioness, an online journal and community promoting connection, confidence, sisterhood, and self-love. Olaiya is the host of the Lioness podcast and also leads retreats and workshops all over the world that help people feel empowered and connect to their creativity. I've been a big fan of Olaiya's work for years now, and I was so thrilled when she agreed to be a guest curator for the library. It's just been such a pleasure to work with her. For tonight's inaugural event, Olaiya will speak with Dr. Devon Price. Devon Price is a social psychologist, writer, activist, and professor at Loyola University of Chicago's School of Continuing and Professional Studies. Dr. Price's work has appeared in numerous publications such as Slate, The Rumpus, NPR, and HuffPost, and has been featured on the front page of Medium numerous times. So please help me welcome Olaiya Land and Dr. Devon Price. Hello.
Hi.
Hello. Hi.
Thank you, Stesha. Devon, first of all, welcome. I am so excited for this talk. I have really been looking forward to this. As we mentioned kind of before the public joined the talk, I first heard you speaking on Caroline Dooner's podcast, The Fuck It Diet podcast, about your book. I'll show the book for anybody who hasn't seen it. And when you were speaking about the laziness lie and this concept of productivity being tied to our worth and how toxic that is, just everything you were saying resonated with me so deeply. I was like, this is amazing. I have to hear more about this. I pre-ordered your book. As soon as I got it, I read it. And it's really not an exaggeration to say that it has changed my life. It has really expanded my thinking on numerous topics, and I have made numerous changes, like based specifically on some of the things you talk about. So thank you. And thank you for being here.
Oh, yeah. Oh my gosh. What a compliment. I'll have to, when we start talking about practical elements of the book later, I'll have to hear what some of the changes are that you've made in your life, because I'm sure it'll be instructive. But yeah, oh my gosh, I'm so honored to hear all of that.
Yeah, absolutely. I'd love to share. And before we get into asking you questions, I just want to talk briefly for everyone who's here about the concept of this talk series. So basically, I don't need to tell anyone that the past 18 months have been pretty rough. So the pandemic, I feel like, really made us in a very visceral way acknowledge how fleeting and precious life is. I feel like the brutal violence that we witnessed against people of color in the past year really made people kind of wake up to the amount of work that we still have to do in the social justice sphere. I feel like we're also, you know, we have the incredibly intense political divide that we have in the US in the moment. And then on top of all that, I feel like there's this visceral feeling of burnout that I feel all around me, that I feel people both in terms of just the regular burnout from work and adulting and societal responsibilities, but with this added layer of kind of like societal trauma from all this violence and political divisiveness and just fatigue from navigating the constantly changing terrain of the pandemic. So I really wanted these talks to address that, both to talk about using radical self-acceptance as a tool for maintaining our energy, staving off burnout, so that we can show up for ourselves, our friends, our families, our communities, but also using radical self-acceptance as a form of activism in and of itself, which is kind of a new concept for me. Last year I was exposed to the work of Adrienne Marie Brown, their amazing book, Pleasure Activism, just like changed my life. And then also, I don't know if you're familiar with the NAP Ministry, which is an organization that does really amazing work talking about how rest in and of itself for marginalized people, specifically Black people, is a really valuable tool of activism and paving a path towards liberation. So I kind of had all these things swirling around in my mind, and that's how I put this talk series together. And so when I made my wish list of people that I wanted to speak to, and I just thought, like, this is the perfect topic to kind of kick things off with. It addresses so many of these things. So yeah, I just wanted to go over that for like everyone listening and kind of like set the scene for the goal for these talks. So let's go ahead and get on into it. I would love to hear a little bit. I always like to hear about the story, the path of people who are doing cool shit. Like, this book is amazing. It's very cool. I think it's important. And you write about, you kind of had this pivotal moment in 2014 that was led to the birth of this book and why, how you changed your life. Somebody's asking about the name for the author of Pleasure Activism again, Adrienne Marie Brown. And hopefully somebody can pop that in the chat for us. It's a really amazing book.
All of her stuff is so good.
Yes.
So good.
It's really expanded my thinking. It's been one of the silver linings of the pandemic for me, is discovering their work. You kind of had this pivotal moment in 2014 that changed your life, changed your thinking on productivity and work, and ultimately led to the birth of this book. I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that.
Sure. Yeah. So my life is, you know, the story of someone who was very much trying to, from, you know, the first 25 years of my life, play by the rules of society that say that your worth is defined by your productivity. And especially if there's something that makes you a little bit different or makes your status in society a little bit more tenuous, you need to really overachieve to kind of make up for that and to kind of carve out your place in a world that won't accept you. So I was, you know, I completed college early. I took college classes when I was in high school to help make that happen. I went straight ahead to grad school. I knew that I wanted to be a professor because I had this idea that then I would be impressive, but I could still be eccentric and I could carve out kind of a life for myself. I finished my PhD at 25. I went straight on to a postdoc and I immediately became incredibly sick. Within a week of my dissertation defense, I was getting these like bone shaking chills every single night. I was running a fever of like 103 degrees every single night. It would just hit me every evening. And it continued from February of 2014 all the way through the spring and the summer. I'm like shivering in like 90 degree heat. It's happening every single night all the way through until like November of that same year. And I had a whole battery of medical tests, you know, rheumatoid arthritis tests, all these kind of like chronic health issue tests. And I had a heart murmur and I had anemia and all of these things. And we couldn't really figure out what any of it was. There wasn't really any kind of diagnosable thing going on. I just had to actually rest, which was just completely unfamiliar to me at the time.
Yeah.
And it was so, I was in such a twisted place at that time that even when I was that sick, I knew it was every evening that I would get sick. So I was still trying to work during the day and work out and do all of these other things and just cram as much productive capacity into the few hours of like good time that I had per day. So of course I wasn't getting any better, right? And so I eventually just had to really grind my life to a halt. I abandoned the idea of making that big push of applying to tenure track jobs, which is something that is just a full-time job in unto itself. And I started doing some freelancing and just like really cut back and teaching online classes, because then I could actually kind of rest instead of jumping around from campus to campus, which is what I was doing. And slowly and surely my health started to recover. And that's what really first got me on the path of thinking about these things. And there were several other moments after that, particularly hearing a lot of my own students who were also struggling from a lot of similar things get called lazy by other professors. That was also a really big wake up moment for me that, wait a second, none of this is working. We are all doing way too much. And this idea that we need to just constantly push ourselves to accomplish more is like destroying our health and our lives. And it's unwinnable, even when you are doing the best you possibly could. It's not sustainable.
Absolutely. And I love that. I just wanted to call out your story because I've heard it from so many other people, the intense pressure to like achieve and be productive and work hard and do all the things to be considered a good member of society is so intense that people have to be like incapacitated to actually slow down. And your story was an example of that. And I just wanted to call it out because I think it maybe is not that severe for everyone, but I hear this kind of story so often. Like I have another colleague and friend who is a doctor who really was like running ultra marathons and just had to hit a wall of like absolute like health problems cascading one on top of the other to actually like take action and slow down. So that tells us a little something about how deeply entrenched this belief in hard work and productivity is in our society, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And I also worry whenever I bring this up, because sometimes people hear this story and they respond by going, well, I guess I can't, you know, relate to this because I didn't work myself to death. And it's like, no. The point is that even if you do that, you never will win. You will never be happy measuring your life by that. So I just want to always.
Yes, I'm actually glad you called that out. Yes, good call. So basically the central theme of the book for people who have not read it yet is that we've been taught to make work the center of our lives in myriad ways and to really tie our self-worth to our productivity. And to kind of explore that idea and debunk it, you talk about the laziness lie, which has three tenets. That your worth is your productivity, that you can't trust your own feelings and limits. And that one's really interesting. I want to talk about that one in a little more detail, and that there's always more you could be doing. But before we get into these, and I do want to explore them, I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about the origins of the laziness lie, because I think it's important to talk about how that is deeply embedded in the foundations of US society and some of the places that that comes from.
Absolutely. So one of the biggest forces for spreading this outlook throughout the US and then through just how influential the US is and is in, as an imperialistic force is like influence the rest of the world is puritanical Christianity. So the Puritans were really religious extremists of their time. That's part of why they came to the colonized United States. And they really had a belief that if you were hardworking and industrious, that was a sign that you were blessed. It wasn't about earning your way into heaven. It was a sign that you had already been basically selected for heaven. And if people lacked motivation for whatever reason, they certainly weren't concerned with things like disability and mental illness and learned helplessness. That was not on their radar at all. If you lacked motivation, you were damned, basically. That was a sign you were a horrible person. And they had a lot of views related to this that were just really incredibly twisted. They really thought children had to be little adults. They even would try and kind of contort babies' like posture with furniture into like adults' postures. Like the idea that they couldn't hold their heads up because their muscles weren't developed enough yet, that was like a shameful thing. This idea that just any limitation, needing any help at all, not being a perfectly diligent tiny adult, that was shameful. So it was like a really absurd level of commitment to that ideology. And the United States or the colonies as they're being colonized, that the nature of that kind of state in the making being what it was, there was a big political use for this ideology. We had a lot of indentured servants. And of course we were enslaving people and bringing enslaved people over to this country. And if you have someone who, they're being forced to work and they're not seeing any benefit to their labor, first you have to justify as a culture why you're doing something that heinous. And second of all, you have to find ways to manipulate people into working against their best interest. And so puritanical Christianity and what we kind of now call the Protestant work ethic also were really useful political tools for saying there are some people who just lack motivation, who lack drive, who are, maybe even subhuman, and we need to give them structure. structure and force them to work because that's like the morally correct thing. And so that's really how we justified enslaving people and exploiting people's labor for a very long time. And after slavery was abolished in the US, we still continued to use that messaging to kind of explain, well, here's why we shouldn't give free Black people and poor working class people in general as well any kind of government benefits, because they're just going to take advantage of the system and they're just looking for a handout and all of these messages. And it's really, it changes its framing a little bit as time moves forward, but not, honestly, not that much. It's been with us ever since, this idea that there are people who are lazy fakers who are going to take advantage of compassion, and that instead, to keep that from happening, we need to just push people to forever work more, do more, take on more, say yes to everything. And it's just really, really deeply infected our culture.
Yes, and that's exactly, I wanted to call that out, because in reading about this in your book and kind of thinking on it more thoroughly, just the way that these threads, we feel like this is ancient history, but it's become so clear over the past year how these threads of colonialism and slavery and the ideologies that we have around that have just kind of like worked their way down through our society and are still being used for the same means today in more whitewashed, more socially acceptable ways. But to me, it's still a force for like extracting the maximum from, like, beyond the maximum, an inappropriate amount of work from disenfranchised people, from marginalized people, I mean, from the populace in general. But so I think it's really interesting and important to consider kind of the roots of this in our society.
Absolutely. Yeah. And the echoes of it are just everywhere, just even in talking about how, oh, we can't keep giving people benefits. People don't want to go back to work, you know, like during the pandemic, it's just taken on a slightly new insidious flavor.
Yes. Well, and my husband and I talk about this, about like, so there's a labor shortage in Seattle. I know a lot of people in the restaurant industry, and I do sympathize with small business owners who can't get enough people to work. But also when we talk about like, so there's a problem with the system. If people are earning more now than they were working, going in and risking their lives to serve people food, obnoxious people who don't want to wear their masks, and et cetera, like, and the fact that people are mystified by that is just amazing to me. So yeah, absolutely. Okay, I don't want to get too, I could talk about that for a long time, so I don't want to get sidetracked by that. But I would love to get into the three tenets of the laziness lie a little bit. So the first one is that your worth is your productivity. And I would just like to talk about some ways, maybe some kind of sneakier ways that this manifests, because in reading your book and thinking on it, like, I just see it everywhere now. So I was wondering if you could talk about some, like, yeah, some of the ways it manifests, and maybe some of the ways it manifests that we don't think about or don't see it as for what it is.
Sure. I think one way that it manifests that a lot of us have seen during the pandemic is this rush that we immediately had when lockdowns first started happening to, you know, bake bread, to like make crafts, to finish that novel, to, you know, learn a new language. And we all had that pressure kind of looming over us before the pandemic began. I certainly talk in the book about how a lot of us think we need to optimize our downtime, you know, like, I need to be taking classes, I need to be, you know, developing new marketable skills. Even during my free time, I should be working. But during the pandemic, that was particularly, especially at the beginning of it, particularly pernicious. This idea that you just need to keep the dread at bay by being productive and showing off what you're accomplishing. The pressure people have to turn any art or creative pursuit that they have into an achievement or into something that you can make money off of is such an intense one. The kind of like Etsy-fication.
Everything has to be a side hustle. Like, if you have any interest or are good at anything, then you need to like monetize that, and that needs to become your side hustle. Yeah.
Right, which just sucks the joy out of it. And yet I also, you know, want to acknowledge that's for economic reasons. A lot of people do that because that's the only way that they can justify to themselves spending money on something that they love, is if they're going to also be able to get a profit off of it. So that's really sad, because we also know psychologically that once you tie an activity to an external reward system, that makes you enjoy it less. That's called the over-justification effect. Yeah.
That really resonated for me, because I have this culinary background. I worked in restaurants for 20 years and had a food and travel blog for 6 years. And at the end of it, so, and then I transitioned to Lioness because I felt like this was more like compelling and a better use of my talents. But also now I can't cook. I hate cooking. I can't, because I just like burn my, like by posting, and I need to make money from this, and I have to sell tours and this. So I have that resonates with me on a very deep level, that I think it will come back. Like, I think this is a healing moment, but that's something that, like, because I lean so intensely into like making that work, that it's just like, I'm burnt it out for me. Totally. Okay. And then another one I would love to talk about, and this one has really been on my mind a lot lately, this idea that you can't trust your own feelings and limits. I've been thinking a lot about all the many ways that modern society disconnects us from our bodies and how detrimental that is to us. Like in so many ways, things as simple as like electric light, making it possible for us to work at all hours of the day and night. And, you know, now we have, you know, 24-hour shift work, and we can all work like a gazillion hours a day, and it disrupts our circadian rhythms, and et cetera, et cetera. Something as basic as like electric light to something like the diet culture, where we're led to believe, that we can't figure out how to feed ourselves. Like, what should we eat? How many, we have to know how many calories, how many macronutrients, what's the timing, you know, how should we optimally work out? So this has been on my mind a lot, this idea that you can't trust your own feelings and limits. So what are some ways that this kind of plays out in this space of the laziness lie?
It's so pervasive. So I'm glad that you highlighted a couple of different ways that it appears. So, and I think starting with the beginning with electricity is a really astute way to bring it up, because I tend to think of it in more recent technological innovation in terms of things like email and Slack and smartphones, that as the boundary between work and life erodes into nothing, which for many of us, it truly eroded into nothing in the past year. You don't have any kind of structure that tells you, okay, I can stop focusing on this task now, and I can actually check in with how I'm feeling, and I can actually honor the fact that I'm feeling antsy and need to go take a walk, or that my eyes are just like burning in my skull and I need to like look at a tree that's far away, do it literally anything but be in front of a screen. But even just the nature of the 9-to-5 workday, or you know, for people working in non kind of office jobs, often it's a lot more punishing even than that. The structure of the workday for most Americans is such that you don't necessarily get to go to the bathroom when you need to go to the bathroom, right? Like that's how Amazon treats its workers, right?
Yeah.
You know, people peeing in bottles are just like not, or getting dinged for spending more than 30 seconds in the bathroom. So even something as basic as that, people working through their lunch period.
Common. I mean, that's become the norm, right?
Absolutely. Yeah. It's some people just don't even, you know, a lot of offices just don't even think in terms of that being something that you have anymore. And those are the really maybe more obvious ones, but it's really profound if you spend all your day kind of batting away the distraction of being a living animal that has physical needs and exists in like physical reality. And so that's why there are some examples in the book of people who were working 90-hour weeks with literally like decaying gallbladders in their bodies, you know, like, and that's how I was able to get as sick as I got without realizing that I was sick until it just reached this absurd breaking point, because it's just so heavily conditioned into us that we're just a brain in a jar, or we're just a body, you know, like chopping vegetables, whatever it is. And this is also true for our emotional limits. We've gotten really conditioned to ignore that we're sad, that we're resentful, that we're frustrated, that we're bored. None of those things are seen as valid as information, even though they actually are really important information for us to follow.
Yes. And then the one place, like we might feel like, oh, maybe it's not, if you have feelings of like, oh, maybe it's not socially acceptable to just like online shop all night long or like whatever, it's always socially acceptable to work. Like if you don't feel good about whatever's happening, or the pandemic has you stressed out, or you had an argument with your partner or whatever, it's always socially accepted by everyone around you to just be like, well, I don't know what to do. I need to like feel better. I'm just going to work. So yeah, totally.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's something where there's just no limit to how much we'll valorize someone if that's what they're kind of
for using
addicted
it as their coping mechanism. Totally. Yeah. And it's just like, that was, I hadn't even thought of that example of like something as the basic human needs of like, I'm hungry, I need to go to the restroom. Like how many of us, I'm sure many people who are watching this can identify with that sense of like not getting up from your, I do it. Like sometimes like, I'll like have to go to the bathroom for like 2 hours and I'll just sit there and keep doing. And it seems small, but it's actually big, I think, because there's so many of those little kind of messages from our body, big, large, and small, that we don't pay attention to. So I love that you call that out so that we can all kind of think on that a little bit more, look for that, kind of learn to use that. And so the third tenet that you talk about is that there's always more we could be doing. And you touch on this a little bit, but you talk about kind of how social media and digital tools for work play into that. And I would love to talk about that a little bit more, because I personally have a very love-hate relationship with social media. And, but it does really, I am very cognizant of the ways that it makes me kind of aware of what everybody else is doing and promotes these ideas of what I should be doing and how I should be spending my time and what success is. And you also touched on email and Slack. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. Yeah. With social media in particular, it just turns everything that we do potentially into something that you can mine for content and use as a basis for social comparison in a way that just really, it's such a double-edged sword, but it really cuts you kind of both ways, because on one hand, it is making you just relentlessly kind of compete and compare yourself to other people and push yourself to do more. And at the same time, it can be really demotivating, because if you're just getting into a new art form, let's say, or a new hobby, all of a sudden you see at the top of your feed the people who are the most accomplished and have the most polished images of it. And so then you can't enjoy it just for the sake of just like kind of dithering around with a new instrument or with paint or whatever it is. So that's absolutely a really huge avenue where it presents. But I think that tenet that there's always more that you could be doing, it really comes down to this idea that you should always feel bad no matter what. Like, even if you are working enough, you're not doing enough for your family, or you're not exercising enough, your body isn't the right shape, you're not volunteering enough, like it just never ends. And when we have that belief system, that also means we can kind of like blame the victim of basically any kind of problem, right? Like, you should have just been exercising more, you should have raised your kids right, you should have done this, you should have done that, you should have been more politically engaged. If you don't vote, you can't complain, all this stuff.
Yeah. And then just the fact that it also like literally never ends, like there's no bottom to our feeds, right? So like you can engage in this like ad infinitum, like this like comparing of your body and like your work status and was your vacation as Instagram worthy as somebody else's, and oh no, I better work harder so I can like make more money, and like is my house big enough, is my car good enough. Yeah, it's really pernicious. I would love to double back, and you talked a little bit about the 9-to-5 work day. I'd like to talk a little bit about the 40-hour work week. You write in the book about how working more does not equal greater productivity. Surprise, surprise. I feel like this is an idea that people are really resistant to. So I'd love to talk a little bit about kind of like the origins of the 40-hour work week and just exploring this myth. This one really drives me crazy. This idea that like you should be sending emails at like 3 a.m. and you know, like working 50 hours is better than 40 hours. So like, what does the data have to say about this? What does science have to say about this?
Sure. Yeah. So first I'll say that the 40-hour work week, of course, was a major victory for labor organizers. And it was really motivated at that time in the early 20th century by industrial means of production. This idea that if you're working in a factory, you know, you should have 8 hours of work and then 8 hours of rest and then 8 hours to do whatever else you want with your life. And that was a big win because people were working like 16-hour days at that time. So we had this huge victory, and work days got shorter until about the 50s, kind of into the post-war period. And then they started getting longer again. And now most people do not have, you know, the 40-hour work week. They have, you know, the 50, the 60, the 70-hour work week and beyond. And that is especially twisted since we know from decades of industrial organizational research that even if somebody has a 40-hour work week, what we've kind of decided culturally is reasonable, people can't actually work and focus on work tasks that time. On average, a worker can only really focus on work tasks for about 3 or 4 hours per day. Obviously, we all have days where it's crunch time and we're really focusing on a project, or maybe we're doing something we actually care about and we can focus, you know, for a day or two far longer than that. But overall, if you're looking at people's actual work habits, if we're seeking to like describe what reality is instead of saying how people should be, that's what it is, you know? And the fascinating thing for me as a researcher is looking at researchers in the 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, today, over and over again, saying, how can we get people to do more hours of work than this? Clearly something must be wrong. What if we change office setups? What if we change management structures? How can we force people to work for longer? And to me, it was just immediately very clear, if this trend cuts across industry and time, why can't we just accept that it's true? That that's just what people are capable of and what's good for them? Because the longer you keep people at work, it's diminishing returns. You're squeezing less and less out of them and poorer quality work, and they make more mistakes, and they're more miserable, and they're more likely to leave. Yeah. So why are we doing any of this?
So I want to put a pin in that and like double back to that. But like, is to me, that feels like very much like part of this like ethos of infinite growth. Like we have more technology, like look, oh, look, we have Slack. Oh, look, we have email. Oh, look, we have all these work tools. So that surely should allow us to like squeeze more productivity out of our workforce. I don't know. That's what it feels like to me, that notion.
Yeah. And it's like objectification. We treat people like machines, and we treat people's work days like they're just something that we can, or their whole day, like something we can just like plug productive time into. When that's just not how humans are. We're living things, you know?
Yes. Okay. So my question for you is, so I have been reading this for like years, like maybe a decade. So why do corporations, like, let's talk about like our hometown hero here, Jeff Bezos, who, yeah, that's a talk. I don't even want to get started talking about Jeff Bezos and Amazon, but like, why do corporations not understand, like, look at the data, look at the science. Why are we still forcing people, asking people to work this way? Like when we realize like, okay, let's actually set the tone of like, yeah, everybody at this company takes their lunch break. Like we're not going to be sending emails after X time at night or whatever. Why is corporate America not taking this data and research, which seems pretty well established to me, into consideration?
Yeah. So I'm going to say something a little bit extreme, but I really, having worked for an evidence-based management like consulting firm for a little while, I really think this is true. I don't think corporate America cares about the data. They care about control because they have never behaved in a way that is supported by the data. The data has shown for a really long time that when you give people autonomy over their schedules and give them some flexibility over their work tasks, and you trust them, and you don't micromanage them, they do better quality work, they're more devoted to the company, they're happier, they're healthier, and they just produce more. So it's both more humane and it's better for the bottom line. And very few companies have ever acted in line with that. Managers often feel the need to justify their own existence by micromanaging, even though that's not evidence-based. That's something that David Graeber has written about in the book Bullshit Jobs, which I highly recommend if people are interested in that topic. And, you know, last year is a really good example of this. A lot of companies were very worried that because people would be working from home, that they would be getting away with not working as much. And so a lot of companies invested in employee monitoring and surveillance software, screen logging software, software that takes screenshots throughout the day.
Oh, seriously?
Yeah, there was a huge boom. Like as soon as lockdowns happened, all these companies started investing. Some companies even just started making employees like screen share on Zoom all day long to like prove they were working. Mm-hmm. And the absurd thing is productivity didn't go down during the pandemic, it went up. It went up by about 40%. Yeah.
Yeah.
So this idea that we can't trust people and that we need to force people into an office and keep our eye over their shoulder to make them work has never been what the data shows. And I guarantee you this year, as we're dragging more people into the office, productivity is going to go down and you won't hear a word about it from business leaders because they don't actually care about what the data has to say, because below the data, they have a much deeper seated belief, which is the laziness lie, that you can't trust people and that you need to control people and that you own your employees, basically. And I think they really are so committed to that ideology that they can't see the truth.
That is both why I don't work in corporate America, but I also understand that like a lot of people, you know, need jobs, and like, I don't want to by any means like throw shade on anybody who works in a corporate job, but it's just really good to think about. And I'm hoping that through talks like this and like talking about the science behind this and like exposing people to this idea is that in some ways, like we can affect some kind of change because it impacts so many people like globally, but also just within the US, like how many people are corporate workers, right? Or warehouse workers or yeah, it's a lot. Okay, I would like to talk a little bit about, well, this is kind of related to this. You talk in the book about wasting time as a basic human need. And I love that. I love like acknowledging that. And you already touched on it a little bit, the idea that we're not robots, that we can't like physiologically, neurologically, we can't focus for 8 hours a day, that that's ridiculous. Like, so let's like just get that out there. This idea that like, that is not reality. That is not, the data doesn't bear that out. Science doesn't bear that out. Just anecdotally, I think we all know that, right? On some level, or maybe we don't, but like, if you think about it, I think that you do know it. But I feel like this idea of just calling out wasting time as a basic human need as like is a radical concept. And you talk in the book about cyber loafing. Yeah, let's talk a little bit about that.
Yeah, so cyber loafing is the research term for when somebody is at work or on the clock and they online shop or they open up Facebook or, you know, they do all of those different things that we do. And just like kind of the conversation about productivity, for a long time, researchers set out to answer, I think, what was entirely the wrong question, which was, how do we stop cyber loafing? How do we make people not do it? And sometimes they would try putting blocks on the internet or, you know, just positioning monitors in a way that you never had any privacy as a worker, all of these things to try and kind of control and corral people's internet usage. Instead of asking the question, what purpose does cyber loafing serve? Or why do people cyber loaf? Which when we look at that, and there is some good research looking into that, people cyber loaf when they are about to switch between different work tasks. So it's a little break, it's a little way of coming up for air, it's a gear shifting tool. People do it to just get a little bit of novelty and a little bit of stimulation. You know, again, we're not robots, we actually do need novel stimuli because we are, again, you know, animals, we're social creatures, we're kind of meant to be kind of exploring the world and interacting with people and learning and discovering new things. We have a need for play and imagination and doing things that are for no purpose. And cyber loafing is just one example of that. But yeah, wasting time really is a basic human need. It's really important for our creative capacity. It's really important for us to be able to even process things that we've learned and store them in memory. We need unstructured time to just kind of screw around. And our bodies and minds can really tell the difference between when we're doing something that our mind is kind of categorized as work versus doing something because we actually enjoy it or out of a spirit of curiosity. And then there's just also that like existential need of a life where you are learning and exploring and doing new things is a more meaningful life. I think when we look back on what our peak life moments are that define our life, very few of them are work related.
Mine's definitely going to be sending emails at 3 a.m. I don't know what you're talking about.
yeah, that was the peak moment, yes.
This is the perfect segue for the next thing that I want to talk about is the benefits of laziness. So like taking it one step further, like let's go beyond like not only not like demonizing laziness, but like you write in the book about some of the benefits in terms of creativity, better problem solving, helping us ascertain what really matters and what we have time for. And so part of me wants to be like, I kind of don't like to justify kind of anti-productivity or not being obsessed with productivity as a means through to greater productivity. Right. But I do feel like that's also can be a useful way in for some people. So I would love to talk about like, and also it goes beyond the workplace. Like there are benefits, I think, to productivity, to focus, to doing more creative, inspired work, but then that also translates outside of the workplace. So could you talk about some of the benefits of laziness and this unstructured time and having space to like breathe and process and think?
Yeah. So I'm glad that you brought up the weird tension between saying that, okay, there are creative benefits and there's productivity benefits to taking breaks and being well-rested, because I really hate the like self-careification or like the self-care industry and the way that kind of, again, corporate America has turned it into another thing that you put on your calendar, another thing that you check off your to-do list. And it's a thing that you do.
And that you buy.
and that you buy, yes, to make you a better worker. And I think if we approach rest and listening to our bodies just as a means to an end, we're still going to always get back stuck in that loop. And it's just going to be another thing to optimize. So yeah, so while it is true that getting enough rest is absolutely necessary for having those moments of insight and perspective that you really need if you're doing any kind of creative work, there are also so many benefits that go above and beyond our productive capacity. So one that is really interesting to me is that when we have just novelty and rest and social connection in our lives, time slows down. People have greater clarity of memory, and just as a like experience of perception, time really slows down for us when we're doing something new and exciting or beautiful, or we're feeling awe, or we're feeling connected to other people. Versus again, writing emails at 3 a.m., time can kind of just go in a blur, and it's like, you know, where did the last year go? I don't know, because I was just in, you know, in the office of my house doing work, right?
Yeah.
So you really are giving yourself more life when you actually are living it and going out and doing things that aren't work. So I think that's a really important one. That element of having insight into what matters in your life that you brought up is, I think, is also a really important one. It's only when we get a chance to step away and reorient and connect with other people and connect with our kind of inner sense of who we are and what we value that we get those big moments of, oh, I'm not on the right path. I need to change things up. And that might be, you know, your career, your relationship, your, you know, creative pursuits, and, you know, who you keep in your life and whose relationships you prioritize, you know, any number of other things. So I think that's another really important benefit of it too.
And I think most of us can like relate to that in terms of like vacations, right? Like I feel like that's something that many of us can feel like when we actually take a proper vacation, if we take a proper vacation. That's a whole nother topic. You write about how like I think 50% of vacation hours are just wasted or some ridiculous amount. But if we actually take a vacation and we come back and it just creates that space to have a perspective on like, okay, is this the right job for me? Like how is my life going? Just that step back so we can ascertain like what is actually happening? What do I want? So that we can make choices. Whereas when we're in like the day-to-day grind, I think it feels like it's so easy to just keep doing what you've always done. And then you don't actually have the energy, you're exhausted. And it's just this cycle of like overwork and exhaustion and not having the perspective or the time or the energy to evaluate and figure out like what really makes life meaningful. Yeah. So I'm glad.
Yeah. Yeah. You push down your feelings, you push down your individuality. You know, I think it's telling that I know several people who during the pandemic, because they had more time alone with themselves and their thoughts, they came out as trans, or they, you know, ended relationships, or they decided to have families after thinking they wanted to be child free for years, or vice versa. Like we get to have big revelations about who we actually are versus who we're expected to be when we like finally get out of that grind and check in.
Yeah, so important. I want to be mindful of the time. And Stesha, could you just also remind me if we're going until 7 or 7:15? I'm sorry, I completely blanked on that. But I would love to, so one topic that's very important and in line with the theme of these talks, but that's also really important to me personally, is how the laziness lie impacts marginalized people disproportionately. Could you talk a little bit about some of the factors that play into that and how that shows up?
Absolutely. So we've already discussed a little bit the really deeply racist history behind the laziness lie. And that is still so deeply ingrained in us and in our culture and in our imagery of who gets described as lazy and which populations of people have to worry about being seen as lazy. So people of color, particularly Black people in America, have to worry a lot about being seen as diligent enough and accomplished enough to just even have their humanity respected or to have even just the slightest hint of stability in their jobs. Here in academia.
Yeah, there's that classic talk that you hear about in the Black community of like parents like explicitly telling their children, like, you're gonna have to work twice as hard for half as much. Like, just know that, like going into the world, right?
Right, exactly. And of course, when parents say that to their kids, they're trying to really set them up for success in a really unfair world and telling them this is just how it is. And yet it also, unfortunately, capitalism really exploits that. Like once you've been taught that you have to do twice as much, that just makes you so much easier to, that can be taken advantage of by the system. And become self-perpetuating. And certainly in academia, one example of this that I see is committee work. It's really hard for people of color in academia to say no to any invite to be on a committee or to take on any kind of initiative. So even last year, as we're having all of the protests and the movement for Black Lives, we're asking our Black faculty members to be on all these diversity and inclusion committees. We're giving them more work at the most profoundly traumatizing time in recent memory for them. So that's one way that it plays out. And that's really, you can see versions of that in almost any industry or any line of work. And then you just also have the economic reality that if you're marginalized in whatever way or in a variety of intersecting ways, you're in a more economically precarious position. So you are more desperate, and that's taken advantage of. We see this in fat phobia. That's another really big one. Our image as a culture in our minds of what laziness looks like is to be fat. And that leads to things like doctors assuming that fat patients are non-compliant and aren't going to take medical instructions or adhere to their medications. And so then they treat fat patients with a great deal of hostility and mistrust. Another really big one is how we treat disabled people in this country and this idea that people on disability benefits are just lazy and they could push through the pain and they just need to like suck it up. And we use that as a justification for cutting benefits or not giving people the accommodations that they need. And that's something that when you look at countries that have done that really harshly, particularly the UK, they've really cut their disability benefits in the past few years and really forced people to prove like, do you really need it? And that's something that's had a real like a body count, unfortunately. A lot of people were forced to go back to work because they could technically stand for a few hours per day or could technically work for a few hours per day. It really eroded their health in like catastrophic ways. So that's just a taste of some of the ways that it plays out, but I could go on all day, unfortunately.
Yeah, there were a couple examples from the book, like one that just always strikes me, but that I appreciated that you mentioned in this book about particularly, for example, like Black women having to straighten their hair or wear styles that make them not only more palatable, but be seen as more professional, because the baseline is already that Black people are less professional or more lazy or whatever. And then you also had another really like, not shocking, but disturbing example in the book of a trans teacher who knew that they wanted to transition and spent, kind of had to like pave the road. They knew that this was going to be really problematic. And so they had to kind of almost build this case of like perfection, of like teacher perfection, like perfect record, like students loving them, and had to like go above and beyond and like basically like kill themselves in this job in order to transition, because they knew that afterwards that they would be under such scrutiny that they had to have this in order to feel safe financially and just, I don't know, financially, physically, like safe in their workplace. So just the many ways that it can play out are really disturbing, and also just, I think, important to see how that shows up in different areas for different marginalized communities.
Yeah, absolutely. And I'm really glad you brought up the point of professionalism, because, you know, we're all exploited to some extent by this economic system, but it's so much more than just what are you producing? It's also, are you showing up to the workplace in a way that the culture finds like acceptable? And if your hair isn't naturally straight, they're gonna make you change that. If you're from any kind of culture that isn't kind of like a white Christian European background, they're going to say that how you dress is a distraction or is unprofessional or sloppy or all of these terrible things. And so it's really a massive like destruction of like people's ability to express who they are and their culture and live comfortably, and just like constant just policing of things that just aren't even relevant to work, even if productivity is what you care about. It's just, yeah, really destructive.
Yeah. I'd love to read a short quote here from the book. You write that constantly having to put on a performance of being diligent, motivated, and well-behaved can leave people feeling like their lives are inauthentic and don't reflect who they truly are. And I really feel this one on a very personal level. I mean, it also leaves you just like tired AF, just this constant like performative experience like in the workplace. But this one like really hit me like on a very personal level as a Black person who grew up in a white community, in a white family. And just like this constant being cognizant of your perception in a way that other people don't have to be, and particularly in the workplace. And just putting this extra layer of effort. I think it's important to call out that people who are marginalized have to put in this extra layer of effort because of this laziness lie that takes a real toll on your physical and psychological and physical and mental health.
Absolutely. Yeah, I've been doing kind of additional research related to that because my second book is about people who have to hide the fact that they're autistic. And so looking at like Black autistic women who have to deal with both like avoiding the angry Black woman stereotype, being very compliant and agreeable, you know, because people will interpret any kind of humanity that is challenging to them in like the most racist ways possible. And then just also the extreme, reading a lot more about like studies on the extreme like psychological toll of having to code switch and just having to change how you present yourself so that you can be acceptable in kind of like white America, and like thinking about how you speak and how your mannerisms and all these things. It's really just a whole other like psychological load that we just aren't even acknowledging anywhere near enough as a culture that people are having to carry.
Yeah, not at all. And I love that you're doing that work. And also one thing that I love about your book and about your work in general is like all the science behind it. Like, let's get into it and let's look at it. And also I love that you're calling out like, this is an area where we need more study. Like we need to look at this, because I'm sure like even just like neurologically, the toll that code switching can take on a person is intense, right? And can make perhaps actually like limit your productivity, like in a real way, not only like your productivity, your health, your physical health. So yeah, it's really fascinating. I want to come back and I want to talk about your upcoming book at the end of the talk. What time is it? 6:52. Okay. So before we take some questions, I would like to talk about, oh my gosh, I have so many questions. I have to just pick the best ones. Okay, quickly, here's something I think that impacts a lot of people. You talk about, so the laziness lies showing up in the workplace. But then you also talk about how that shows up in our personal relationships and setting healthy boundaries, and how emotional overexertion is kind of a corollary to overwork in the professional space. So could you speak a little bit about what that looks like and a few tips for stepping out of like emotional overexertion in our relationships?
Yeah. So one way that I like to think about it is that the laziness lie has basically made it really difficult for us to really listen to our true voice of like enthusiastic consent in almost anything that we do. So if you always think that it's morally superior to say yes, to do things, to take things on, and that you have to always justify saying no, not doing something, not being available for something, that's always gonna immediately skew your ability to listen to your own inner voice. And so I think a lot of us are in a position where we kind of sustain relationships that aren't healthy for us, or we're trying to manage expectations from overly demanding family members, or trying to also just shoulder the burden of caring for friends who are in need for very genuine reasons, but we just, as a society, don't have enough social supports in place to help take care of those people. So then we feel like it's all on us as individuals to fix it when we're like overexerted ourselves. So those things manifest for all of those reasons. And I think one way to kind of get a little bit more comfortable with navigating this stuff is actually challenging yourself to disappoint people once in a while, and building up a little bit more tolerance for the feelings of guilt and distress that you'll initially have being honest with yourself and with other people. So that was something that I talk about a little bit in the book that I just kind of set for me personally, like basically one of my like therapy homework challenges for a while was I need to find at least one person that I'm going to disappoint every week. And, you know, not out of any sense of malice, but just in terms of the fact that I had constructed my whole life around, I'm never going to disappoint anyone. I'm always going to live up to everybody's expectations. I'm going to meet everybody's needs. And I need to learn to say no and not take responsibility for how someone else feels.
Totally. And I remember when I was first learning to set boundaries, like I literally felt like I was going to like have a panic attack or throw up. Like it was so stressful to me that like I'd been so conditioned to like never like cause a fuss, like never be difficult, like always, you know, accommodate people as much as you can, that to take any opposite action, like had a like a really powerful, but like physiological, like I really felt like I was about to have a panic attack when I first started like practicing with setting boundaries. So yeah, I love the idea of making it a weekly practice. And I love that you also call out in the book, like to do it, to start small, like with some small ways that maybe don't make you feel like you're going to throw up and have a panic attack.
Right. Yeah. You can kind of ramp it up, and that helps train people to set new expectations for you, especially if it's someone who you really value the relationship, but it needs to change. So like family members, for example, I think we have this big, like individualistic, like I'm going to just be assertive and I'm going to completely change everything and I'm going to be confident today idea. And that's just not how that stuff works a lot of the time. It's a slow ramping up or ramping down.
Yeah. And also you give the advice to be a broken record, which I think is important because a lot of us have the idea that we can like set, we kind of like psych ourselves up and we're going to like set this boundary or like disappoint our one person for the week or whatever. But it takes time to change those patterns. I mean, like depending on how old you are, those patterns can be like deeply, deeply ingrained. So I love that advice of like part of this process is to be a broken record, to protect your own energy, to protect your own mental and physical space.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think some of that also goes back to the idea that you're training yourself that you aren't actually responsible for making the other person get it. Boundaries aren't actually about the other person. It's about you. So you're just holding firm. I can't do that. I'm not available for that. I can't help you out in this way. I'm sorry. It's like, you don't actually need to add more of an explanation if that's just what it is. You just think that you have to.
Yeah, that can be really tricky. Okay, before we get into questions, just quickly, so this is probably like what everybody is wondering. So what can we do? What can we do to work less? Or like, what are some practical tips that people can take away from this talk? Like maybe people are thinking about things in a different way, wanting to change things up either in their workplace or in their personal life or with their family. Like what would you say are like a couple of your biggest tips that people can use for starting to take action, working less or not? You talk about achievement hunting, like constantly being after that hit of the next achievement and never savoring it. How can we change these patterns?
Yeah. So the first thing I do want to always highlight is this is a systemic issue. And so we're ultimately are going to need systemic solutions. I don't want to overlook the fact that those of us who have the ability to cut back more at work and in life and set more boundaries, there's an element of privilege that often goes along with that. So, you know, each person knows their own situation best. And so, you know, what the lay of the land is at your work. So you may have to think about what can I get away with and who can I join forces with to kind of build up our power, whether that's unionizing or documenting problems as they're kind of repeatedly occurring, or just finding someone who can kind of help cover for you and isn't going to be the type of person who's going to tattle on you for coming in late or whatever it is. Just, you know, people who you can actually trust to treat you with humanity. I think that's a really important thing. I'm a big advocate for finding ways to kind of lie, cheat, and steal for free time at your work if you need to. You know, scheduling meetings with yourself on the calendar so that just kind of like blocks out time that people can't claim if you are in a workplace that's very ruled by the Outlook calendar. Highly recommend that kind of thing. In terms of just looking at your life in general, not just your work, but certainly also your work, start with the base assumption that you are already doing too much. Whatever your life looks like right now, and I'm not talking about your to-do list of what you aspire to do, what you're already doing right now, you're doing too much. You're exhausted. What are the things you can let go of in the service of freeing up more time for things that will make you actually be happy in your life and have things to look forward to and feel like are in alignment with what your values are. So that's often a really useful place to start, I think, to seek to like describe what your reality is. Like going back to that idea that instead of imposing an 8-hour workday, we could just notice that people work 3 to 4 hours and just accept that. Instead of saying that you should get XYZ number of things done, just observe what your habits actually are, what you're actually capable of, and just radically accept that and accept feelings that tell you, okay, I'm actually pretty emotionally checked out by 3 p.m. every day. Why am I trying to force myself to do more? If there's a way that I can get out of having to do that, if I can get away with walking away, I should be doing that.
Totally. Yeah, and then just to wrap it up, and this is kind of the ending of your book, a book which is not only informative, but also really moving, like particularly the ending where you talk about compassion and compassion as the, how compassion kills the laziness lie, why compassion is the key. So I'd love to end on that note and then head to questions. In what way is compassion really important for rooting out internalized capitalism and this laziness lie and living a more fulfilling life?
Yeah, so the first tenet of the laziness lie is that a person's worth is determined by their productivity. And so the way to combat that is to actually believe and behave as if every human life has value, every person has value, and that is completely unrelated to what they do or don't do. It has nothing to do with how they live. It has nothing to do with their choices. It has nothing to do with what their abilities are. Everyone deserves dignity and autonomy and respect and to live in a reasonable degree of comfort. So I think often it's far easier for us to start by practicing this belief, applying it to other people. So if there is someone in your community who's on the corner asking for money, instead of thinking about whether they really deserve it or if they're going to spend it in a way that you would approve of, just giving them that money or just advocating for, you know, more social supports in your community for people who have been really left behind by the way that our society currently works. When we extend compassion to other people and actually try to live as if your productivity has nothing to do with who you are as a person and all humans are valid and beautiful, and life in itself is beautiful, that makes it so much easier for us to actually believe it about ourselves and just completely reorient what our priorities are in life.
Yes, I love that. So powerful. And also can be so challenging. I remember the first time I heard this concept that you don't have to do anything to deserve love and like some internal part of me just like recoiled. Like, what are you talking? It like shattered my, I just like didn't want to hear it. I didn't want to accept it at all. But like having really worked to move towards that and to really accept that, it's life changing. To be able to both extend compassion to others, but also to extend compassion to yourself and really accept that we all have value just for existing. So I love that you call that out in the book. Okay, awesome. Let's get into some questions. We have like about 10 more minutes left. So let's look here. Okay, somebody's talking about like, what is the ideal schedule for workers? Yeah, if you had a magic wand and you were gonna redo our corporate, like our classic corporate American day, what do you think?
We would not have a standard day. People would work when working worked for them. People have different, people have different sleep schedules. People have different, you know, work styles. I don't think we actually need to impose something from the top down. I think it needs to be way more bottom up and giving people autonomy and trust. Yeah.
Totally. Such a good answer. Yes. Let's see another question. Okay. So people are really interested in this topic. So Mariana Coles writes, what does the ideal work-life play balance look like? Are there models or near models in other countries? If so, what is the underlying belief in that culture that makes it work? And I really like this question as somebody who's lived abroad, and actually living abroad for me was kind of my gateway into having a different perspective. I lived in France and Belgium, did my master's degree over there. And I was like, oh, wait a second. Like, we don't have to be killing ourselves constantly and we can take meaningful vacations and actually engage with the pleasure of life. So yeah. Do you think, are there any countries that you think are great models or?
Yeah, so the first thing I would say, it's funny that the question kind of has in it the idea that there is an ideal. And I would wonder, like, ideal in what way, right? Like, I think we still think that there's a way that like human life has to look. And I think a lot of this work is about kind of like letting go of all of that and saying a lot of how we think that life has to work, maybe it doesn't even have to look like that. So on the one hand, yeah, there are a lot of useful cross-cultural comparisons to make because the US is just one of the most workaholic cultures in the world. So even places that are pretty similar, like the UK, have a much more like when the workday is over, you go home and you don't think about work kind of approach. And of course you have countries that have kind of siestas kind of normalized and things like that. But I think we should also look beyond like to like before the Industrial Revolution created the 9-to-5 and how did humans live like in the days of early agriculture and even before agriculture and in societies that still don't kind of follow kind of like a chronological, like 9-to-5 kind of schedule. Like people spent a lot of time historically throughout most of human history, just like telling stories. And, you know, there was a lot of things to do because people didn't have tools to make work easier. There was a lot of like food prep and cleaning and things like that. But like, if we look like anthropologically throughout most of human histories, people did not work more than a few hours per day, and their lives weren't defined by a work schedule in the way that we think of it now. Time was a lot more cyclical and more responsive to nature and the seasons. And it was more about people kind of joining together and making art together and spending time together, and even things like food prep and kind of taking care of the community was something that was had a sense of playfulness and connection built into it. So all of that is just to say, like, we can really expand our horizons if we stop kind of thinking that working as much as possible and producing and growing is the most important thing. That frees us up to like really change how we even think communities look and how life looks. And so I don't know what the ideal is, and I don't think there is an ideal. And oh my gosh, what fun to think about what the possibilities might be.
Yeah, such a good answer. Like, let's just explode the whole fucking like 9-to-5 workday and like really get in touch with like what, you know, our needs as individuals and how this can look. And I love the idea of imagining new possibilities. Okay, I want to get to a few more questions. So Michael M writes, a lot of today's discussion reminds me of my 12 years of public school. Oh, especially the demands of attention and productivity that seem unreasonable to ask of many, many children. Absolutely. Do you have any thoughts on reforms that could happen there that relate to today's topic? Such a good question.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Well, let me just also say that if you're an educator, you're also so, so overworked. So you're a huge part of that equation too. We treat our students like little workers. You know, it's based on preparing them. Our educational model is based on the Industrial Revolution and preparing kids to be good little factory workers. And it's just not, you know, that's just not the right way to treat children. And it's also not the right way to treat teachers. So I think there is a lot of lessons to be learned from the unschooling movement. And just the idea of, again, giving children a lot more latitude to study the things that they're passionate about and listen to their bodies and be able to sleep in when they're going through a growth spurt and all of those things. But to even get to that place, we would need so many more resources put into education because, you know, I'm here in Chicago. We have students, you know, my partner's a teacher, like we're talking like 1-to-45 student to teacher or teacher to student ratio, you know.
Wow.
It's just really dramatic and grueling. So that's not a very helpful answer, but I do just want to highlight just how intense it really is and how I think we really need to care for both our kids and the people that take care of our kids so that we can treat both of them more humanely.
Yeah, I think even just calling attention to this, like, I think a lot of people don't even question the school model, like, this is how it's been, and, like, so it must be a good model, but, like, is that actually serving us today, our children? Is it actually designed for how children function, and does it produce the results that we want? So even questioning that and calling attention to it, I think, are important. Here's another really good question. Anonymous asks, how can I make a living off my passion without ruining it for myself? I'm an artist and want to move into turning it into a business. So if that, what did you call it?
The overjustification effect.
Yeah. So what if we are an artist or we do want to make money from something that is a creative pursuit? Are there any ways to mitigate that effect?
It's tricky, but I think if you can, as much as is possible, try to separate the art from the metrics. So not being fixated on how many likes did I get on Instagram today? How many clients did I get today? You know, did this piece of art sell for more than this last piece of art? That's hard because if you're trying to make a living off of your art, there is some degree where you're going to notice those metrics, right? You're going to be affected by both those things. But if there is a way that you can find to put some kind of firewall between the act of creation and, you know, following your passion for the sake of it being the thing you're really called to do, and that kind of external approval chasing that is sometimes part of the business, I think that would be a really important thing for you to think about. Like, how can you set limits on how much that stuff kind of comes in? And then also finding ways to kind of resist the pressure to monetize your work in ways that you know won't line up with your values. So just figuring out for yourself, what are the hard lines of types of clients you won't work for, or types of work that you know, even if the money might be really good, it would really kill you inside to do. But yeah, it's really tricky. I think it's always kind of a tightrope to walk, yeah, for sure.
And for everybody listening, there's a really good example in here of somebody who was kind of giving their work away on Twitter and shifted and kind of like caught up in the likes and the heart points and everything, and really shifted into realizing the true value of their work. I think that's really instructive. That's a good example from the book.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And she's a screenwriter, so she does make a living doing it. So it is possible to still like your work.
Yes. Okay, two more questions. Let's see. What kinds of, Anonymous asks, what kinds of collective action would be required to make a meaningful difference on a broad scale? Any regulations or policies that you think are achievable? So yeah, are there any specific, like one or two specific examples of collective action that you are particularly excited about or interested in?
Sure, yeah, anything that's kind of a move towards unionizing, general strikes, things like that. I think we're getting more and more to a place. In some ways, the way the economy has been lately has almost been kind of a quasi strike, because people are saying, you know, we're not taking this anymore. We're not going to take these jobs that are like putting our lives at risk, that don't pay enough. I am really galvanized to see people are more on board for talks about things like universal basic income. We're certainly not there yet where most people are on board with it, but I think we're, you know, just keep having those conversations, keep talking, you know, with people that you work with when it's safe to do so, and people in your community about this idea that we need to have a safety net in place. And I think that momentum is building, and there's always ways that we can. Even just having conversations with people about this stuff is really meaningful on the ground action to get us there.
Totally. And actually, I think that is a great place to stop. So before Stesha jumps back on here to wrap this up, could you both talk briefly about your upcoming book and also tell everyone where they can find you and learn more about your work and follow you?
Sure, yeah. So Laziness Does Not Exist is out. And then in April, I have a book coming out called Unmasking Autism, Discovering the New Face of Neurodiversity. And that is with Penguin Random House. And that is pre-orderable now, if that's something you're also might be interested in. And I write on a like pretty much a weekly basis on Medium at devonprice.medium.com. So you can read that stuff for free. And then on social media, I'm like Instagram and Twitter, I'm at Dr. Devon Price.
Yeah, and I really recommend following Devon on social media, just like you speak on such a broad variety of topics. And I have learned a shit ton from following you, and it's really given me a lot to think about. And then also sometimes it's just entertaining when you post pics of your pet chinchilla dump truck.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Again, that's what makes it not feel like work, is just posting whatever I feel like, right?
Yes, I love it. Okay, thank you so much. It's been a real pleasure to speak with you.
Thank you so much for having me. This was great.
Thanks so much to both of you. The comments are amazing. Just, I'm not sure if either of you have had a chance to follow that, but people are just so grateful for the conversation. They've been joining in with their own experiences, and I'm trying to scan quickly to see if we can say, people said that it's one of the most illuminating events that they've ever attended. And this event is really eye-opening. I'm really enjoying it. So thank you to both of you. Thank you, Olaiya, for curating such an amazing event. And Dr. Price, thank you so much for your work in this area. I think that we could easily keep talking all night, but we wouldn't want you to have to work all night. So yeah, we can't do that. So as a reminder for folks that are watching, you can find books by Dr. Devon Price at our partner bookseller, Third Place Books. You can also find Dr. Price's books at the library's website, spl.org. We've been putting links in the chat, and I also just put a link so you can pre-order Unmasking Autism as well from our friends at Third Place Books, and those are all in the chat there. And as I mentioned at the top of the show, we're interested in hearing from you. We'll post a link to a program survey in the chat, and we'd love it if you take a minute to share your thoughts after the event. And we're so grateful to everybody who made tonight's program possible. Thank you so much, Olaiya. This is a great way to launch your series, and can't wait for the next ones. And in fact, maybe we should have people save the date. I'm just remembering, October 13th, Dr. Lindsay Kite, talking about body resiliency and her book, More Than a Body. And October 29th with Amanda Machado. Yep. Check the library website just to make sure I'm not making that up, but I'm talking about BIPOC access to the outdoors. So those are just two coming up in October, and we have a ton more coming down the road. We're so grateful to our program partners, Third Place Books. We're grateful to our sponsors, the Gary and Connie Kunis Foundation, the Seattle Times, and the Seattle Public Library Foundation. And of course, thanks to all of you for joining us tonight. The chat was amazing. It was wonderful to see folks so engaged. And thanks so much for watching. And we'll see you next time. Good night.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye. Thanks, everyone.